Today, I'm with Associate Professor Simon Rosenbaum. Now, Simon works at the School of Psychiatry at the UNSW, University of New South Wales in Sydney, and is an honorary fellow at the Block Dog Institute. Now, Simon's research focuses on physical activity, mental illness, sport for development, and global mental health. Now, Simon's worked with a variety of groups, including youth, veterans, emergency service workers, and refugees. Now, Simon's published over 200 peer-reviewed publications, including a textbook titled Exercise-Based Interventions for Mental Illness. And now he's certainly one of the world's leading experts in the field of physical activity and mental health, and I can't believe he's speaking to me. Now, Simon serves as an elected National Director of Exercise and Sport Science Australia, and he's the President-elect at the Australasian Society for Traumatic Stress Studies, and he co-chairs the Olympic Refugee Foundation's think tank on sport and humanitarian settings. He's led international research in capacity building, including working with the Rohingya refugee crisis in Bangladesh. Now, Simon's passion and expertise means he's in high demand, so I'm really grateful for your time this morning, Simon. How are you going?
I'm good, except having to listen to that, but thanks, David.
Yeah, well, soak it up, because obviously you do a lot of work in this area, and I'm sure you've heard it many times, but yeah, it's amazing all the work you do. So we'll get straight into it, Simon. Obviously, you're really busy with, you know, academia and all your research and all your projects. But how do you look after your well-being when you've got all this on your plate?
Yeah, I don't really. If I'm perfectly honest, it's hard. I think, you know, one of the things that makes me even more passionate about this work is that I see for myself how important it is. You know, I know that I don't do well at finding balance typically, but I know that for me, I feel much better when I'm active and when I'm exercising and when I manage to get that aspect of my life under control. And it doesn't happen often, and it goes through phases, and I go through periods where I'm not doing much, and like now, and then I have to sort of, you know, I know that affects me, it affects how I feel, it affects how I do everything, how I interact with the world, I guess. So you know, there's that firsthand experience of how I know that when I move I feel better, and why that's important. And I guess that translates to me wanting to help spread that to other people who might be experiencing that but haven't had the same privilege as me of being able to know what it feels like to be able to move.
And what are some of those things then that you do to look after your well-being?
So I really enjoy kayaking, also climbing, you know, walking outside, anything typically outside. I used to do a bit of bike riding and mountain bike riding, but it's just, you know, the older I get, I think, and a lot of people face this, the harder it is. It's not like, you know, we said just offline that you're training for an Ironman, which is, you know, incredible. And I think I admire the passion and the ability to make that a priority. And I think that's a key part of this, isn't it? It's making that decision that this is going to be a priority in our life, and that it's actually not selfish, that it makes us, you know, in a better position to be able to help other people as well.
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, in terms of some of those pillars of well-being, what you know, have you got any things that you really focus on? So you've talked about a lot of the exercise there. Is there any other things?
Yeah, I think, you know, increasingly this whole area about is being referred to as what's called lifestyle psychiatry. And so it's looking at those lifestyle factors. So that includes, you know, movement, so our exercise, it includes sleep, it includes nutrition, and things like smoking and substance use. Mm-hmm. So, you know, for me, the big ones I'd say would be movement, sleep, and diet. I don't smoke, and I don't drink a lot of alcohol. You know, I know that they're all related. So when I'm training or when I'm exercising, I sleep better. Also makes me more interested in my food or my nutrition, because I know I'm going to exercise better and I'm eating better. They're all related. And I think the challenge is that they can all be overwhelming as a whole, but if we sort of take individual aspects of it and we sort of focus on one thing, it can then help to break that cycle. You know, and something that I definitely can relate to, and I know a lot of people do, is this idea of all or nothing. You know, right now you said you're training for the Ironman, so you're probably in peak condition, but you've got those things.
I don't know about that.
Well, look, I think it's pretty amazing. Even considering an Ironman is incredible. But for me, it would be like, okay, what's if I'm not doing anything and things are bad, like what's one step I can take? And it might just be that I'm going to go to the gym for 10 minutes. There is a gym at the end of my street.
Yeah.
And so even if I'm feeling really bad, if I just drag myself there, and even if it's 10 minutes, it's a start. You know, it's kind of the analogy of when I need to write something. If I really just am having this block and I can't do it, if I just tell myself I just need to write 25 words or one sentence, because if you manage to do that, then typically what happens is the rest, you're then in that zone, you've done the hardest part, the rest will come.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love that. And it's definitely around momentum, isn't it? You know, you get one of the pieces to the wheel, I suppose, and, you know, a lot of the others follow. I've heard you talk about green and blue gyms. Can you just explain what you mean by that? Because I find that fascinating.
Yeah. So there's a bit of data about the sort of added benefits, if we think about the mental health benefits of exercising outside. So that's the sort of green gym. And then you've got the blue gym, which is in water. Now, I think we've got to be careful about saying that, you know, you have to be in water in order to get any sort of benefit from activity. You don't. It's about where you live and what you have access to as well. Water's an added bonus, but for some, you know, again, it's this idea about what we enjoy, and we all speak about this a lot, but, you know, we need to find something we enjoy. That's critical. But we do know that there's added benefits of stuff that's outside, and also the social interaction that can come. You know, we've got to move away from this idea that being active or movement is going to a gym. That's not the only option. You know, that's going to work for some people, but not for others. And so that green gym refers to those added benefits that we see from being able to participate outdoors and get those extra benefits.
And obviously you've built your career on looking at the link between physical activity and, you know, improving mental health or people's mental health recovery. You get asked this all the time, but yeah, what's, you know, if you could give a little kind of overview of, what is the link really? And I'm sure there's a lot in that question.
Yeah, for sure. But it's also quite simple. You know, we can narrow it down into saying that when we move, we can feel better.
Yeah.
And it's kind of as simple as that. And so some of the important things is that there's no one type of movement that we have to do. It's up to that individual, just like there's no one diet. You know, I think anyone that is spruiking a message that you have to do this type of exercise program or this, like, it's just not true. You know, for each, it's considering the individual person, but also their individual context. You know, where are they living? What is their environment like? What are the socioeconomic status? What's the social capital? What are the things they have access to? Is it safe to walk on the footpath? Do they have the required clothing that they need in order to participate? Mm-hmm. You know, I think there's a lot of onus placed on the individual as if this is an individual choice. It's not as simple as that. It's not just the choice that someone chooses to be active or not. I mean, there's a lot of privilege and a lot of factors that actually give someone the ability to engage in that and to be active. So I've wandered off the question, which was, what is the evidence? The evidence is that the exercise can help, movement can help. So if we think about mental health as being a spectrum, you know, from good or optimal mental health through to poor mental health, the same way that physical health is, you know, we could have good and bad physical health and it fluctuates. We might have a cough one day, we might have a broken toe, or, you know, so our physical health changes, and it's the same with mental health. And you can be along that spectrum without necessarily meaning that there's an illness there. And so I think the important point to note is that regardless of where someone is on that spectrum, movement can play a role in contributing to us feeling better and in contributing to mental health. The challenge is that when we have people that may be experiencing poor mental health or experiencing mental illness, there's additional barriers to being active that we need to try and address and try to help people work through, so that we can actually provide an enjoyable, safe way of engaging in activity that's appropriate for that person at that point in time.
Mm-hmm. And I think listening to you around, you know, there are obviously certain social determinants of health which are important for people, whether it's shelter or food, and they can have a big impact on, you know, what your exercise. But I've heard you talk about, you know, the refugee camps that you've been in, you know, whether it's, you know, in Bangladesh, and, you know, some of the ladies getting up in early in the morning and walking around, you know, before people get up. So there's definitely what things that people can do. Which I think is fantastic to hear. But obviously privilege does come into it as well. And, you know, I, from my perspective, I hear the industry, or what the, I suppose the health and wellness industry, talk about, you know, go exercise, get them endorphins going and you're feeling so good. But there's so many other benefits to exercise, like you're talking about, with like your physiology and, you know, maybe dopamine and things like that, to achievement. And yeah, would you like to just unpack that a little bit from the other stuff?
I mean, I guess coming back to that, you know, you sort of spoke about the hierarchy of needs there. You know, we need shelter, we need water and all those things. And that's true. But like, we also need meaning. Mm-hmm. And we purpose. And so I think there, you know, increasingly, I've just finished a really interesting course around refugee mental health. And there were people raising, like challenging this notion of that sort of Maslow's hierarchy, and actually saying that meaning and purpose and future and optimism and, mm-hmm. you know, are actually equally as important. And it's not just providing physiological needs, because then you're essentially just, you know, and unfortunately the Rohingya crisis is an example. People are stateless and people are stuck. And there's, for a lot of people, there's difficulty in finding meaning. Now, I think sport can actually, you know, we've seen that it's universal, it's transcultural, it can provide a bit of meaning. So, you know, I think I am very conscious of that idea of the hierarchy of needs, but also, you know, for a number of years now, since I probably started the work in Bangladesh, I've been, you know, thinking about that and constantly asking whether that's actually, whether there's an alternative around that, and where sport and where community. And so you've mentioned those other benefits of activity beyond just the endorphins, and I totally agree. I think, you know, just look at how important local sporting organisations are in rural communities. You know, I was really lucky this week. I was up in Dubbo at a suicide prevention conference and hearing some of the community members there talk about how important in those communities sport was as a way of addressing all sorts of inequality and all sorts of issues facing that community. Because it's not just the players, it's the people volunteering in the kitchen, it's the people volunteering as the referees or umpires, it's, you know, it's actually about community. So I think there's so much more beyond just thinking. I mean, I saw the same things in Bangladesh, you know, with the role of sport. So it's not just the individuals, there's broader aspects there that I think we undervalue or underappreciate a lot of the time.
Yeah, it's not just the playing field, is it? It's everything that comes around it, and you know, certainly that social element is huge. And I'm really, really interested in this next question I'm going to ask you. So I'm not building it up too much, but it's something that I think about quite a lot in terms of marginalized groups, or, you know, helping those most in need. If we look at the health and wellness industry and thinking about like aquatic centers, leisure facilities, recreation centers, and, you know, we have all these services and programs. You know, how can we do more to support people in their mental health recovery? You know, so it's not just a program. Just what's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think, I mean, I'd like to put that back to you, because I'm more interested in your views, because it's not an area that I'm really familiar with. My take on it, though, has been that we need to create spaces and that are what we say are mental health informed, or that actually cater for people and are destigmatizing, are friendly, are welcoming for people, no matter where they sit on that spectrum of, you know, optimal to poor mental health. So I think it's thinking about, I mean, you know, if we just take commercial gyms, for example, like they're quite an intimidating place if you haven't exercised. I mean, you know, I studied exercise for years and, you know, but like, you know, I'm a skinny dude walking around at a gym. It's an intimidating place. And so if you don't have a level of, so you need a certain level of confidence, I think, and a certain level of familiarity to actually step foot in one of those places in the first instance. And I, you know, don't want to call this out, but there was when I came home from Bangladesh, I was in an Airbnb and across the road was a gym. And they had this advertising sign that said, you know, I think it said, smaller waistlines, bigger smiles. And I kept noticing it, but it made me more and more angry over time, because, like, actually, this is entirely what's wrong with that industry. And, you know, because what that implies is that unless your waistline is small, you can't be happy. I know the message they're trying to get across, but actually it's not helpful. We shouldn't be shaming people around weight and body image. And I'm kind of wandering around here, but I think that's really critical to the sort of exercise facilities in that industry. And how do we make these centers genuinely welcoming for people? How do we make it less intimidating? I know there's great examples of people doing great work, but I think one of the issues there is training. You know, the mental health sector need training in physical activity and training in sport, but likewise the sport, physical activity, allied health sectors need training in mental health so that we're actually aware of this, be able to stick within our lane in terms of knowing what our scope of practice is and refer onwards. But I think there's a lot of room for upskilling, and it's not just around, you know, we talk about health literacy, it's also mental health literacy. How do we ensure that our workforce, people that are coming in contact with the community, sporting coaches, sporting clubs, I think we've done a really good job at breaking down stigma. People are talking about mental health, you know, things like Are You Okay Day, there's initiatives everywhere, which is great. But how do we take that to the next level now and actually provide basic skills, training, things like mental health first aid, so that, you know, accidental counsellor training courses, things like that, that give people that are likely to come across people that are struggling the ability to actually then take affirmative positive action. And I think when we look at the statistics around how many people are likely to experience a mental health condition throughout their lifetime, it's about 50%. You know, at any one point in time, it's about 1 in 5. So it's super common. So if we're working with people or groups of people, we're going to come across this. Either we ensure that we're as well prepared to deal with it as possible, or we kind of ignore it. And I think what we're seeing is a shift towards sectors like physical activity and sport, sporting organizations, saying, actually, we have a responsibility, we can get involved, we can contribute.
Yeah, it's definitely multifaceted in terms of making those facilities, you know, more welcoming, and education is definitely part of it, Simon, isn't it? And that's why I think the mental health first aid training. But, you know, this with mental illness, from my understanding, you know, there's so many levels, isn't there? You know, whether it's psychosis or depression or mania, and you know, to get an understanding of that it takes time, and there is a lot of stigma around it. But if it's 1 in 2 people who suffer, you know, from mental illness in any, you know, in their lifetime, then if you look around your colleagues, you know, there's going to be somebody there that's, you know, that's going through, you know, some challenging times. So I'm optimistic around that, where we're going with it. I think we're talking about it more, as you said, and more training's happening. But there's a lot more work to do. And I think while subsidies sometimes are good, you know, they can be used by people who are already fit and healthy. And I think, yeah, like you said, the way we market these facilities is, you know, it's usually to the fit and healthy, isn't it? And not to the average Joe, maybe, who's, you know, who's the people that really need it. So, I think we'll just have to keep moving that one and doing the work that we're doing to support people. And in terms of chronic diseases, you know, if you could nudge one part of the system to reduce chronic disease, and we know that 1 in 2 Australians have got a chronic disease, you know, what would that be?
It's tricky. It's really tricky. I think, first of all, we need, I'm thinking this through as we go. I would say that I think there's an acceptance that activity and movement is good.
Yeah.
And we need to help people do it. I think there's been this interesting, you know, over the past maybe 20 years, this idea about, you know, exercise is medicine, for example, those sorts of initiatives, which are fantastic. I think in some settings, there's almost a risk that we over-medicalize and we go too far in the direction of, you know, medicalizing someone's lifestyle, which has its role to play. But I think we also need to think about what are the factors leading or predisposing someone to become or to be inactive in the first place. Is it that they had a horrible experience with physical education at school or PE at school, and we know that that predicts exercise behavior long term? You know, is it to do with the community in which they live, or the access to safe walking spaces, or something like that? What are those sort of broad, almost systemic factors that we need to take into account? That's the first thing. How can we address that? And then, you know, that's also an impossible question, because we're then talking about, you know, these wicked problems, so to speak, things like inequality and climate change and all these things that actually do tie into this. But then there's also the individual level, and what can we do at the individual level to support people when they maybe come in contact with either the health service or if it's the sport sector. I think one example here in Australia, we're really lucky that we do have these referral schemes. So things like allied health, you know, chronic disease management plans, but we know that they're, you know, really, really underutilized. So we're not making use of the infrastructure we have. I think we need better integration between the allied health sector or the health sector and the sort of fitness, leisure, sport world. Mm. Because if we think about the risk of over-medicalizing exercise and we sort of pull that back, then that is saying, what are the resources available in a community at a given point in time, and how do we better utilize those, and how can we maybe tweak those resources so that they do cater for people that otherwise wouldn't attend? So that also comes down to the training. I feel like I'm just going around in circles.
And what do you think the disconnect is there between those? If you're saying that we've got that infrastructure, you know, allied health, and we're talking about, you know, fitness or, you know, health kind of the sector, you know, how come we're not joining that together and connecting the dots?
Yeah, I think it's a good point. There is that disconnect. I think there's a disconnect between maybe health, the health world, and maybe the fitness or sport world, when actually everyone's kind of doing the same thing. It's about how do we safely get people moving more? And there's a room for there's so much need that there's work for everyone across that spectrum. So I think we need more awareness of what people do and how services work. We need to think about what's the level we're targeting. Are we targeting whole communities or individuals or both? And we need both. I think we need to be really aware that people's activity over time changes. It fluctuates. It goes through peaks and troughs. And now, you know, if you're 5 weeks away from the Ironman, sorry to keep bringing that up. I'm super impressed.
But you're terrifying me every time you say it, Simon. Stop it.
I'm just jealous. I'm just totally jealous. But it's, you know, you're probably going to have some time off after that, and, you know, things are going to change. So
yeah, about a year.
Yeah, exactly. So it's, I think, thinking how do we have the right resources to match the need of the individual? And that's also keeping in mind that we need a combination of that individualized, specialized support, but also generic group-based programs that might also work. You know, I'm sort of thinking like a stepped care approach, and sort of thinking that, you know, like the stages of change model, people are going to be in a different period at different points, but we need to match the support that we provide them to where they are at that point in time. You know, one example, one of our PhD students, Grace McEwen, is doing some great work using Facebook and recruiting people with a sort of shared identity, whether it's emergency service workers and their families, putting them into these closed Facebook groups and providing kind of generic support and advice around moving more. Now, that isn't an individualized exercise program per se, but it's having a similar effect. But we need to then have other opportunities available, because we know that people are going to engage differently and change over time. And it might be that they were playing sport, team sports, but then their participation dropped off. They then might need some one-on-one support to get back to that. Or it could just be a friend saying, look, we used to play footy together, why don't you come back to the club? Mm. So I don't think I'm giving a clear answer here, but I think it's about having lots of different tools available that match the need of an individual at a certain point in time. And the more people that are trained, that are familiar with what the resources are, and that, you know, also the mental health sector being aware of what are the sporting physical activity services in that region and what's right for that client at that point in time.
Yeah, that connecting people into the right services, and I think is what I'm getting there. And obviously, if we're wanting to improve population health, you know, around, you know, in this wicked problem of chronic diseases, it's we've not fixed it yet, so it's not an easy thing to do, is it? And it's, I know that question's challenging because it's not just one thing, but I'm trying to gather as much, you know, information from these conversations as possible from the different areas to try and bring it together in my mind, you know, in terms of how to try and tackle some of this, Simon.
I think, sorry to cut you off, I think one of the key things for me, and again, this just comes from the conversation I was having in Dubbo recently and the work that Grace is doing around the peer workforce. And I think particularly with when we talk about mental health, there's a big push towards in working with a peer workforce. That's people with lived experience. Mm-hmm. And they are the experts by experience. And it's really amazing what happens if we just ask them, like, what do you need? And it's the same with refugee contexts and communities I've worked with. Like, the best thing we can do is actually just ask, like, rather guess, say, like, what's going to help you and how do we support you? What's needed? I mean, some of the communities I've worked with overseas, they don't need me coming in saying play sport. They're absolutely aware of it. What they need is, you know, the resources, the infrastructure and the support around that to make that happen. And yeah. I think we've got to take the same approach here and think about who are we trying to reach, where, and then asking them what do you need and supporting them to do that.
Yeah, just listening, isn't it? I think is so important, and cultivating, facilitating the conditions for them to be able to, you know, do it themselves. And I was interested to look at the World Health Organization and, you know, the chronic diseases, or I call it chronic conditions, that it lists, and you know, mental health isn't in there. And I just found that interesting, and yeah, just wanted to get your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I can't comment directly on that because I'd need to have a look, but I guess what I would say is that I think often when we think about non-communicable diseases, I mean, you know, depression, anxiety is a non-communicable disease, but we often, it's left out, and it's those sort of silos of healthcare and that sort of physical mental divide, where, and you know, it's interesting, I know there's a poster that I use in slides sometimes, and it's from WHO, and it says reduce your risk of cardiovascular disease by, and then it's got these four images, and one is, you know, exercise more, eat better, don't smoke, and sleep, or don't drink alcohol or something. But you could actually just cross out cardiovascular disease and insert mental health or mental illness there. And those factors are related to our mental health. They're completely related. But I think when we think about this idea of a healthy lifestyle, we automatically link it with physical disease or preventing physical disease, not with mental health, but the evidence is there too, and it's hugely important. So I think I would just, you know, commenting on what you're saying, it's probably just the fact that I think a lot of the times mental health is left out or it's forgotten. But actually, in so many of these health promotion initiatives, we could just cross out physical health and put mental health, and it's the exact same thing. It's not a cure-all. You know, it's not, we're not saying that just if someone moves a bit more, it's going to cure their depression or cure their, you know, PTSD or whatever it is, but it can help. You know, it can be a big part of recovery. It can be a big part of management. So I think they're the sort of words that I like to talk about, you know, rather than this idea of this illness, which people often think that they're, you know, sort of have this label for life and that things may not improve. It's actually like there's great examples. People can live a really, you know, an equally contributing, and this is words from mental health sector, contributing life, and this idea that people can recover and people can, have fulfilling lives, and that activity and movement can be a big part of that.
Yeah, and that thing that comes into purpose, doesn't it? And people having meaning in their life, and which I think is important for us all in terms of our well-being. So move on to my last question. And so, you know, you're a rock climber, you're an academic researcher, you know, you're doing all these projects, you know, and even internationally, and I know I'm not doing you justice there, but where do you see yourself personally in the system, and, you know, how do you contribute and influence it?
It's a funny question, because I probably have a bit of an identity crisis at the moment. Like, there's a bit of an existential identity crisis, because I'm a bit confused.
You're doing too much.
It's that my role's kind of, I started as I studied exercise physiology and then did my PhD in PTSD. At a hospital working with mainly veterans and emergency service workers. So I'm kind of in this weird space where I don't actually know what I am, David. Like, I see myself, you know, what I'm really passionate about is probably generating academic research. Not because I think people read it. I'm not naive at all. People don't read it, but people want to know it's there. And nor should they have to necessarily read it. But people want to know it's there and want to know it exists. But what I'm really passionate about is actually how do we use that to actually influence practice? So how can we take that data and take that sort of science that we see it and actually use it to change stuff? And, you know, there's this thing called the implementation gap in science and medicine, which is this gap in between research and practice. And typically it's about 17 years. You know, there's been research on this issue, which means that research that's happening right now, that it's, you know, likely up to 17 years before people in the population will actually benefit from that. And that's just far too long. You know, we really need to speed that along. And that's where this idea of implementation science, which is this whole field around how do we actually implement scientific findings into practice. That's what I'm most interested in. How can we do real world research? I think there's a gap between the sort of, and I'm not talking about basic science here in terms of benchtop science. You know, we owe those people our COVID vaccine and all sorts of stuff, which is amazing. That's not what I do, but it's not that one's, you know, they're just different. Mine's at the other end, which is that sort of implementation and how do we actually shift practice. So I'm interested in things like, well, what are the barriers to a mental health clinician talking about exercise in a hospital setting or in an inpatient unit, and how can we address those barriers and what needs to happen on the ground? So I guess that's where I see myself. And also what I'm really passionate about is that I think there's so many amazing people, charities, organizations doing incredible work on the ground. They don't have the capacity to do research in a way that the sort of scientific journals and academics want it, but there is a balance there because they're both equally valid, and actually we can learn the most about practice from the people that are on the ground day to day doing that work. That's where that best science, the best research questions come from, because it's from people, you know, in the field, so to speak, or on the ground. So that's where I'm really, what I get really excited about, you know, is how can we evaluate and show that those things either work or don't work, but then inform that in real time, ideally. I think that's probably it.
Well, that's pretty cool. And I'm going to squeeze one more in, just because it was interesting what you were saying there with your answer around that implementation gap. So if what we're saying is, you know, one in five have a mental health illness, and, you know, any one in two, you know, suffer during their life, is from the research and the data that you've looked at, is that going to, say, in 10 years time, so, you know, 2031, will that have reduced, or do you think it's going to increase?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I mean, it depends. The answer to that would be it depends, which is a really frustrating answer, and I hate saying that. But it sort of depends on the populations we're talking about and the context and the age group and all that sort of stuff. I think, you know, take COVID as an example. Mm. You know, I think we're going to have a lot of people, whether it's you know, emergency service workers, frontline workers, people that have been through a really traumatic time and still are in countries in the world right now. I mean, we're so unbelievably lucky here in Australia. Places like India and what's happening there at the moment, there's going to be, you know, enormous amounts of people needing mental health care and support. And I think that is a given. And I think the more awareness, the more people are talking about it, hopefully the more people that are coming forward and actually seeking help. So I think we need to be prepared for that as best as possible. And what I would say again is not that sport and exercise replaces anything within the mental health sector or within the way we address mental health issues. It actually should complement it and be alongside it. So what I would say, you know, the ultimate dream or goal for me would be that if someone comes in contact with a mental health service, or even before that, but ideally they, you know, comes in contact with a mental health service, immediately their physical health is addressed from day one. So their exercise, their diet, their sleep, and they've got access to the support they need in order to address that. You know, and I sort of feel like I'd say this a bit, but, you know, the worst case scenario from that is that we improve someone's physical health. The best case scenario is, based on the evidence we have, you might change or prevent certain episodes of things like depression or alter the trajectory of the illness itself. So there is some good prevention data. So that's probably the way I would see it, is why, you know, everyone should have access. You know, exercise should be a right. We all have, you know, a fundamental human right is the right to health. And we know that exercise is pivotal to health, physical and mental health. So therefore it should be a right. It shouldn't just be this privilege that only a few lucky few have access to.
Fantastic, Simon. So that brings us to the end, and I know you've got to jump off quickly, but is there anything else that you'd like to add that we've missed?
No, thanks for having me. I think, you know, it just, you know, would be great. I think we need more voices in the area on this topic. So I think, you know, I'm equally would love to hear, you know, I know you're doing some great work, and hear about how, you know, if people do have novel ideas. I think big programs come from small little pilots and ideas that spark somewhere. So yeah. The more of those that we have, and the more that those sectors can work together, I think the better.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, well, I'll let you go and hope to catch up with you soon in person, Simon. And yeah, thanks again for you know, giving me some time, and all the best for the rest of the year.
Thanks so much, David. Good luck with the Ironman.
Yes, I'll let you know how I go. Cheers.
Cheers.
Bye.